Harlow Malty Medicine Hat, and thank you to Damien Patrick for that malt mention, introducing, as it does, Whisky Review 575 here in the Manx Bothian, somewhere in the Isle of Man. I'm Ralphie, and I'm going to smell a whisky, taste a whisky, tell you about it, give you a malt mark, and then, importantly, give some additional and extra information to help you make smarter, cleverer, more informed decisions about what whiskies you're going to buy and enjoy. If you like big, heavy, peaty phenolic whiskies, you'll certainly enjoy this. Laphroaig 10-year-old, bottled at 40%. Sure, it's got a little bit of caramel colourant in it, I have no doubt. Sure, it's been chill filtered, you can see that. I wish they didn't do that, malt mates, because if they didn't, we'd get a richer, more flavoursome dram. We would, you know. Sometimes my opinions carry a little bit of the weights of facts. This is one such situation. I've reviewed this whisky twice in the past. So this is a re-review for 2016. A timely, time-capsuled update comparing this whisky, as I'm tasting and smelling it now, from a recently bought bottle, to the first time I reviewed Laphroaig 10-year-old, 7 years ago, can you believe it? Yes, March 2009, and it was Whisky Review number 30. And then I did a re-review in Whisky Review 501, which is 74 reviews ago. So it's kind of relatively recent, but I'm quite mindful that we're increasingly seeing the situation out there that with the price of whiskies, particularly with older age statements on them, in fact, with the price of peated whiskies in particular going the way they are, finding an available, affordable, good representative single malt, particularly an official bottling from Islay, it's not as easy as it used to be. And Laphroaig is a very good example of that. If you like the really, really, really heavily peated whiskies, you're going to love this. If you're not quite sure, I recommend you buy a bottle or even a miniature and try it out, because if you fancy yourself as a whisky buff, you've got to try the spectrum range of flavours. And even amongst heavily peated whiskies, Laphroaig is out there on its own. It is such a particular, distinctive, phenolic single malt that you've got to try it at some point. What can you expect? My goodness, it's a big nose. A really big nose. In fact, when you buy a bottle and remove the cork for the first time, take a good nosing straight out the top of the bottle, because at that point is probably the most mineral, antiseptic, chemical, phenolic experience you're going to get in terms of smell. Once the whisky's poured into a glass, it tends to mellow slightly. Once it oxygenates in the bottle over time, it tends to become more defined, more complex. But initially, in first experience in the nose, you're getting something that's really slightly harsh and very, very heavy. Burnt treacle, chimney smoke, soot, trichlorophenol, bandages, antiseptic, medicinal stuff. That's what you get with Laphroaig. When I first reviewed this, I talked about fireworks and storms and all the rest of it. I want to give a slightly different take on Laphroaig this time round here for Whisky Review 575, because over time our tastes develop. Never ever be under the illusion that we gain a sophisticated palate over the space of 10 years and then that's it. It doesn't work like that. If you're being open-minded And if you're listening and in tune with your own sense of smell and taste, you will find that even after you become experienced, your palate continues to change and alter the way you perceive an experience of smell and taste in any quality liquor. That will change simply because we continue to build up that catalogue, that library of memory and experience and whatever we've consumed. I find the experience of heavily peated whiskies a bit more mellow than I used to. Perhaps it's because I've come across some real bruisers. Look out in particular for younger independent bottlings of Laphroaig. That's L-E-D-A-I-G, which is peated Tobermory from the Isle of Mull. That's, you know, if you want a big, heavy, peaty moment, that is a very good option if you can't find a Laphroaig. Also is Peat Smoke from Benromach and Longrow from Springbank. But at the moment, we're with Laphroaig. It's generally available. It's not too expensive, so it's an affordable Isla whiskey generally. And it's well worth the effort, really well worth the journey. If you're just coming to a heavily peated whiskey for the first time, have a wee taste and then put the bottle aside for a month. Yeah. 2 weeks then. In a dark, cool cupboard. First experience of Laphroaig is like nothing you've smelt and tasted before. And I'll tell you why. Because with Speyside whiskies, like Macallan and Aberlour and Benriach, good examples, what you get is a predominance of fruity notes and some slight savoury at times, a little hint of peat in the background with Macallan, but you're getting recognisable smells and flavours that you can associate with what you've eaten in the past, whether it be fresh fruit, whether it be the rind off an orange, whether it be a handful of raisins or some almonds or walnuts. When you come to smelling most whiskies, you have this recognisable association. Not so with Laphroaig, because we do not eat. We do not smell and taste burnt licorice. We do not lick chimneys, the inside of warm chimneys, the morning after the fire from the night before. We don't do that. Therefore, what you're smelling and tasting is something that you cannot recognise from previous experience, and it's intimidating, it's off-putting. Flavour. My goodness, you're straight past slight savoury fruit notes, some crisp grapefruit rind, yep, some kiwi, a little bit of kumquat, but then suddenly, boom, blast of mineral, sooty, smoky, very smoky, medicinal, first aid kit style of flavours. It's advisable not to drink TCP, trichlorophenol. It's antiseptic. It's what you dab in cuts and grazes. You'll find it regularly features in sticking plasters. And of course, when you taste this, you think, hang about, we don't taste sticking plasters. We don't smell chimney soot, seaweed. Seaweed, by the way, can be very, very tasty if prepared properly as a vegetable and highly nutritious. But generally, seaweeds don't feature in our diets, although they should. And that's what you're getting here in this whiskey. You're getting distinctive saline seashore notes and crushed seashells. Now, there's another thing we don't smell and taste are seashells. Salt, sea-laden, wet seashells. I mean, when did you last go down to a seashore, get down your hands and knees and start licking the stones? Exactly, me neither. And yet that's what we're getting here from this Laphroaig. And that is why you've got the shock of the unfamiliar. And that's why it's so off-putting to so many people. You need to give yourself time. Take it slowly and gradually. Even if you want, get a bottle of vodka and cut the Laphroaig. 20% Laphroaig, 80% vodka, make sure it's good vodka, and tone down the Laphroaig in some relatively neutral spirit, and that will help you get to know it a lot better. Now, for an old stubborn old hack like me, frankly, bring it on. I just love these young age statement, heavily peated whiskies that you get from independent bottlers. Your Port Charlotte's far more than Octomore, by the way. Port Charlotte's a lot more interesting. But your young Lagavulins, your young Lechigs, oh, fantastic. Very intense, only a little in your glass, but it's memorable. It's engaging and it's substantial and it's different, and that's what we enjoy about spirits, quality spirits, particularly single malt Scotch whisky. I'm going to add some water now. This whisky, by the way, we clue in the fact that it's been bottled at 40%. It's a house brand. It's a young entry-level whisky. It's spirit-driven. You're not talking about a lot of matured cask complexity going on here. In a sense, that's quite a good thing because the casks are distinctly average in this. You know, they're basically ex-bourbon casks that have been used, well-rinsed. They're not donating a lot of richness to the nose and the taste of this Laphroaig. But never mind the substance of phenolicism. Can I say that word? Of course we can, malt mates. It's a malt moment. If this phenolicism of this whiskey, it stands on its own 2 feet. It doesn't need any support act to help it deliver the experience. I've added some water. Brings out the dry, fruity notes more. I've never tasted an unpeated Laphroaig. I'd love to. I suspect it would be very reminiscent of Scapa, some flinty old dry mineraled Scapas. Fantastic whiskies, but not in tune with the current fashion for sweeter, fruitier dressed whiskies, which are happening at the moment. That's another conversation for another vlog. Nose, added water, it's just less. It just smells dilute, simple as that. But in the flavour, in the palate, really good tongue coating. It's right in the middle. A pancake of peatiness, minerality, savoury, dry, charcoal, calcium, seashells, lime, as in limestone, not lime fruit. Again, I'm noticing in the background behind that smoky, almost it's amplifying the sootiness in this dram, is the grapefruit rind notes, bitter grapefruit rind. The main peat treat, it's really there from immediately it hits your palate, right through the development to the finish. The development is not bad, the finish is quite short. Has a little bit of stewed tea and dry gingeriness about it. But all in all, a very palatable, pleasant, complex and challenging single malt, which it tastes a little bit rawer than it used to, but in fact, it also tastes a little bit better than I remember in the past. And I'm going to quantify what I'm saying here by just reminding us all, yes, malt mates, because we need to be reminded, our palates continue to change. They do not develop up to masterclass mode and then stop. For those that do not allow their senses to become stereotyped and pigeonholed, the journey continues and a reinterpretation and appreciation of range of smell and tastes is an ongoing, continuous and permanent journey. And I recommend that you treat it as such. There's a sweetness coming through now. Not really a cask sweetness. A kind of honey note appearing in the background. Not so much oak, but honey note. And it's just kind of coating the minerality, the sootiness, the peatiness, the smokiness, the brininess of this whiskey. 87 out of 100. Yes, malt mates, it's got to be a malt mark. It is a malt mark. What else? The stills. Here is a picture. I'll bring it forward and let you see it. You can have a look at the picture instead of me for a minute or two. Have a good look at what I've marked with my permanent marker there. See in the corner here? That's the wash still. That's a wash still at Laphroaig. And here is a spirit still at Laphroaig. Have a look. Next time you pour a glass of single malt, go on to your search engine and bring up images of the stills at that distillery and have a look at the stills. Look closely at the stills. Here at Laphroaig Stills, they're essentially slightly elongated squat pots. Big broad pot, big fat neck at the top, at the shoulders of the still, and then you have this broad funnel of the ascending neck of the still, at the top of which there is what's called the line arm. Some line arms go up, some line arms are horizontal, and some line arms go down. Whichever the angle of the line arm will have a very immediate effect on the style of the distillate, the shape of the still, the size of the still, the broadness of the neck, the height of the neck, all factor into the new make spirit, which determines the intrinsic character of each and every single malt out there. It is a useful thing to explore as you get more used to the whiskies that you're tasting and smelling. Go and have a look at the stills online. Look at pictures, look at videos of the distilleries. You know, every distillery should have a photo library of what they have. I mean, they should do it. Every distillery should have that, and they should be in charge of it, their own messaging. But if you look at the spirit still here, you see how the shoulder of the still, the pot, pinches in to a tight waisted neck prior to ascending up the column, the neck of the still. That creates reflux. Reflux is when the rising spirit coming off the heated water starts to circulate in circles, like storm clouds. Yep, well, just like storm clouds, starts to move in circles up and down. It rises up, it cools down, it drops. It gets heated up, it rises up, it cools down, it starts to drop. And this is constantly ongoing until the, like a blanket, a gas of warm cloud, it builds up and then over the top of the still. The higher the stills, the longer it takes, the more refined the spirit becomes. Particularly for tall stills, look at Glenmorangie. Perfect example, even Bruichladdich. And you'll find with tall stills, you do not necessarily get such intensely phenolic peated whisky unless you slow the stills down a little bit and you take your cut further and further into the faints. See, when, and I conclude with this, when you first are heating a still, the first liquor to rise out is methanol, which is the lightest, the most volatile of alcohols. That's got to be discarded. I'll tell you about that later in another video. Then you've got the lightest of the ethanol family. but it's also the lightest molecules can have the weight to carry the least and lightest of molecular flavors. And therefore, when you get the first portion of your hearts, of your cutout, a still, any still for any liquor, it's its least flavoursome. It's only as the heart, over time, continues to be drawn off as clean spirits that you want to keep and put in casks, that you've got to raise the temperature in the stills a little bit to maintain the inertia of distillation. And with the liquor heating to a higher temperature, heavier ethanol molecules come off and carry bolder flavours, until, of course, we start to move into the area of faints, where it comes to the point about 30%, depending on the still you're using, spirit still, you really, 30%, you start to get soapy notes, off winey notes, vinegar notes, what you call the faints, which are not particularly pleasant, but ideal for recycling into the next batch. So there you have it. My original message stands, malt mates. When you're getting to understand your smell and taste of spirits, go and have a look at the stills. Don't look too closely. Just clock them. Pay attention to them. You'll learn a lot from them. Laphroaig. There's plenty of independent bottlings of Laphroaig. The prices are vary quite a bit between independent bottlers. Some are shockingly expensive, particularly older ones. And some affordable younger Laphroaigs can be really occasionally quite weird tasting, so be mindful of that. Laphroaigs, I tend to buy official bottlings Laphroaigs now and again. Here's the 1989 17-year-old Laphroaig, and here's the 12-year-old Kirdas. I have bought these not because I'm a cynical, hardened, speculative flipper. I'll tell you about flippers later. But because I recognise, as we all should, that when you come across a good whisky, buy a second and a third bottle and put it aside in a dark cupboard. I've just brought these out of a dark, cool cupboard, and I'm just going to put them back in a dark, cool cupboard. But before I do, let me point out something that I like to do. When I buy a whisky, I make sure it's good nick, nice and presentable. And I put a luggage label on it, saying how much I paid for it. If I've got the receipt, I staple the receipt to it. I put a few wee comments about why I've bought it, where I bought it. And for the comment I've bought on this luggage label is for 2007 Fischl. So this is a Fischl bottling at 50.3%. So I know if I look after this bottle, it is unlikely to deteriorate. If anything, it's going to continue very slowly, very gradually, if at all, to mellow and mature over time, just because it's stored in the bottle. Now, I may open this bottle in 1 year time, 10 years time. Hopefully, I'll do it before I die. That's the plan anyway. But even if I don't, I've already made provisional arrangements that there are friends of mine who are going to have a rather large party. And when they do, if this bottle's still around, they'll finish with it, not start with it. If you are attending a whisky festival or any whisky function or group or whisky club or whatever, never start your evening with Laphroaig if it's on the table. Leave this whisky to the end of the night, the end of the afternoon, the end of the event, for a very, very simple reason. It is so heavily flavoured and particular that if you drink it early on, every other whisky thereafter will be tainted with peatiness and Laphroaiginess. I'm just telling you, so as you know. It's one reason I'm here, malt mates. Got to keep you right. Anyway, right. Next whisky review, 576. I'm going to review another version of Lagavulin for this very simple reason, malt mates. I'm in a peaty mood moment at the moment. And it'll be the distiller's edition, a recent distiller's edition, easy for me to say, version of Lagavulin. Looking forward to, I've already had a few tastes and I'm thoroughly enjoying it actually, and I'm going to be reviewing it for you. Yeah. I'm Ralphie. Thank you for joining me. I hope you have enjoyed this satisfying peat smoke reeked malt vlog moment. And as always, steady as you go, malt mates. Take it easy and keep it quality. And there you have it.